Dear students, today we are going to talk about the antihypertensive drugs. So what are the antihypertensive drugs? The drugs that lower the elevated blood pressure towards normal. Okay, so the drugs which actually decrease blood pressure. Decrease what type of blood pressure? Decrease elevated blood pressure, or they decrease high blood pressure, and they tend to decrease this high blood pressure and bring back this blood pressure towards normal. Okay, so these are antihypertensive drugs. So let's look at some basic physiology. What is hypertension? Hypertension is pathologically elevated blood pressure which is sustained for a long time. Okay, no problem. Then let's look at the blood pressure levels. The normal blood pressure level, we say that it is 120/80, systolic and diastolic, right? So if you say that this is a very average, okay, that can vary, okay, in a range. We are not getting into those things. Now what is prehypertension? When the systolic blood pressure is from 120 to 139, diastolic from 80 to 90. Okay, and then the stages of hypertension. There are two stages of hypertension. One is stage 1 hypertension and stage 2 hypertension. Stage 1 systolic is from 140 to 159, diastolic from 90 to 99, and stage 2 systolic more than 160 and diastolic more than 100 millimeter of mercury. Okay, and you will learn these things in details when you will study medicine. Okay, now let's come to the basic mechanism of blood pressure lowering drugs. So this is a very simple figure to show you the basic mechanisms of blood pressure lowering agents. Okay, now let's look at here. Suppose this is your heart, this is right atrium, left atrium, right ventricle, left ventricle. Now what happens, that blood comes to the heart through these veins, okay, and blood leaves the heart through these arteries. Now how blood pressure is made, right? You can remember from the knowledge of your physiology that blood pressure is a product of cardiac output and total peripheral resistance, right? Now these two factors actually contribute to the blood pressure, to the generation of blood pressure. Now why these two factors are important? So let's take a simple analogy, very simple analogy. Suppose this is a water filled piston, okay? This is a water filled piston and it has a very small tube attached to it. Now suppose this is filled moderately, this is filled by water moderately. Okay, when you will press this piston, suppose you are pressing this piston by your hand, you press this piston, then water will come out through this tube, right? Water will come out through this tube. And when the water will come out through this tube, this water will exert pressure on the walls of this tube. So that is the blood pressure, that is our blood pressure. So the pressure in this tube is dependent upon two factors. One is the amount of pressure exerted on this, okay, the amount of pressure you are giving, and another factor is its diameter. Its diameter. If this tube is very narrow, suppose this is the piston water, moderately filled water, okay, and this tube is very very narrow. What will happen if you press the piston? Then water will come out very forcefully. Okay, so number one thing is very narrow piston. If the piston is very narrow, the diameter is very narrow, then the you exert normal pressure and the water will come out very forcefully because this tube is very narrow. And another factor is if you press this piston with more force, with more pressure, you are applying more pressure here, then with the same diameter the water will come out forcefully. That means that will exert more pressure here. See, so you can say that this is the cardiac output. Okay, the pressure, this pressure you are exerting, okay, and this is the diameter. Now if you underfill this this piston, suppose in this, within this piston there is very less amount of water, and this is the diameter, normal diameter of the tube. If you press this piston, do you think the pressure will be same here when the water will come out, or the pressure will be low? Of course the pressure will be very low. Okay, so if you feel this, there will be more water coming out and there will be more pressure. If you overfill it, okay, if you overfill it, then again much more water will come out and the pressure will be much more. Okay, and if this tube is very wide, if this tube is a very wide tube, so if you press this piston, the water will come out with less force, the pressure will be very less. So you can imply this analogy here. Okay, now suppose the venous return, this is the peripheral organs, from the peripheral organs the venous return is coming. Okay, the venous return is coming to the heart, the ventricles, okay, from the pulmonary veins, from the pulmonary veins, blood is coming here, the pulmonary veins, blood is coming here, it's coming, and now the ventricles are now filled. So the ventricles are now filled, and the ventricles, when the heart muscle will contract, that will eject blood, through these vessels, aorta and pulmonary arteries, right? So what will happen if you overfill these ventricles? More blood will eject, more blood will be ejected, and the pressure will be more. So if the venous return is more, the end-diastolic volume will be more and the blood pressure will be more. Okay, the contraction will be more. This is number one. And number two, if the heart muscle, the contractility is more, and the, suppose here the end-diastolic volume is normal, but the heart muscle, the cardiac contractility is much more. The heart muscle is very strong, very strongly contracting, then the pressure will increase. Of course, that will eject blood through these things, through these arteries very forcefully, and the blood pressure will be increased, right? And this is the second thing, the cardiac contractility. And the third thing is the total peripheral resistance. That means resistance in these vessels. So blood is coming out from the left ventricle through the aorta into the arteries. Okay, so there are peripheral tissues, arterioles, and those arterioles have resistance. As I have mentioned in the analogy of pistons, that means so the heart has contracted and the blood is coming out through these arteries. So if you can remember that this is the piston and the diameter is normal and the blood pressure is, sorry, the water is coming out from this and here exerting some pressure. If the this tube is very narrow, suppose these arteries are very narrow, then the pressure will be high, and if the tube is dilated, the pressure will be low. So if you dilate the arteries, okay, if you dilate the blood vessels, then the diameter will be increased. Here the diameter is increased and the pressure will be low. So these are the basic mechanisms of blood pressure lowering drugs. So you can decrease blood pressure by decreasing the venous return. You can decrease the venous return, you can dilate the blood vessels, and you can decrease the cardiac contractility. So by these three mechanisms you can decrease the blood pressure. So you can read it by yourself. Okay, I have discussed the things here. You can pause the video and look at the description here. Now there are some non-pharmacological methods of blood pressure reduction. For example, physical exercise, avoidance of extra salt intake, avoidance of smoking, avoidance of alcohol, weight reduction if the patient is obese, relaxation. Suppose you can advise the patient for meditation, then avoidance of red meat, etc. So these are the non-pharmacological methods, and you are very less likely to be asked about these methods in your pharmacology exam, because pharmacology deals with drugs and medicine. In your classes of medicine, you will learn about these non-pharmacological methods in details. Now come to normal physiological parameters that control blood pressure. As I have mentioned earlier, cardiac output controls the systolic blood pressure, and total peripheral resistance that controls the diastolic blood pressure. Now come to the classification of antihypertensive drugs. Number one, diuretics like as furosemide, thiazides. But as antihypertensive drugs, furosemide is not a good antihypertensive drug. So you will not say this drug, you say thiazides. Okay, for diuretics, antihypertensives are mainly thiazides. ACE inhibitors like captopril, enalapril, ramipril, etc. ARBs, angiotensin receptor blockers like losartan, valsartan, olmesartan, telmisartan, etc. Beta blockers like propranolol, atenolol. Calcium channel blockers like nifedipine, amlodipine. Then you have alpha blockers like prazosin, terazosin, etc. There are some other drugs like vasodilators, hydralazine, sodium nitroprusside. These drugs are mainly used in emergency hypertension. Then you have central sympatholytic drugs like clonidine, methyldopa. So in this class we will talk mainly about the ACE inhibitors and ARBs. So the ACE inhibitors means angiotensin converting enzyme inhibitors. These are ACE inhibitors. Now let's look at the renin angiotensin aldosterone mechanism, because the ACE inhibitors and ARBs, they act on the renin angiotensin aldosterone mechanism. Renin angiotensin aldosterone mechanism. Okay, now as you know from the knowledge of your physiology that in the renin angiotensin aldosterone axis, when there is less blood flow to the kidney, suppose these are your kidneys, when there is less blood flow to your kidneys, then the JG cells of kidney become stimulated and they release renin. Renin is an important enzyme. So the JG cells, they release renin. Renin then converts angiotensinogen to angiotensin 1. Angiotensinogen is a protein that comes from the liver and that is converted by renin, which is released from the kidney, to angiotensin 1. Then the angiotensin 1 is converted to angiotensin 2 by angiotensin converting enzymes in the lungs. So angiotensin converting enzyme, that is ACE, is released from capillary endothelium of lungs. Okay, so capillary endothelial cells of the lungs, this angiotensin converting enzyme comes. So this converts angiotensin 1 to angiotensin 2, and this angiotensin 2, this angiotensin 2 is a very very important product or important agent which has a variety of actions. Okay, so let's look at the functions of angiotensin 2. Angiotensin 2 acts on the angiotensin 2 receptors on different organs, right? So number one, on the vascular smooth muscles, mainly on the arterial side. So constriction of arterial smooth muscle, arteriolar constriction, and by constriction of the arterioles, they increase blood pressure, increase the diastolic blood pressure. So if there is arteriolar constriction, that will increase the total peripheral resistance, right? By increasing by causing the arterial constriction, they will increase the total peripheral resistance and thereby they will increase the diastolic blood pressure. And then they also constrict the venous smooth muscles. So venoconstriction, increased systolic blood pressure, because venous return will increase and thereby that will lead to increase in end-diastolic volume and that will increase systolic blood pressure. That also stimulates the zona glomerulosa of adrenal cortex and thereby it stimulates the release of aldosterone. And what does aldosterone do? Aldosterone increases sodium and water retention in the kidneys. Okay, sodium and water retention via the kidneys, and that leads to increase in blood volume. So increase in blood volume means increase in venous return, and increase in venous return means increase in end diastolic volume, that will ultimately lead to increased systolic blood pressure, increased cardiac output and increased systolic blood pressure. They also act on hypothalamus and they increase thirst. And another important thing is they stimulate the posterior pituitary to increase the release of ADH, antidiuretic hormone. So antidiuretic hormone causes increase in water reabsorption from the collecting ducts of the nephron, and thereby it increases blood volume, increases blood pressure. Now what are the functions of ACE, angiotensin converting enzyme? So angiotensin converting enzyme mainly does production of angiotensin 2. That means by ACE, angiotensin 1 is converted to angiotensin 2. So it converts angiotensin 1 to angiotensin 2. So there is increased production of angiotensin 2. And another important function of this enzyme, angiotensin converting enzyme, is breakdown of bradykinin. They inhibit the synthesis of bradykinin or they stimulate the breakdown of bradykinin, and bradykinin is a vasodilator. Okay, and let's look at the functions of bradykinin. Bradykinin has a few functions, like number one, in the lungs. Okay, in the lungs, it causes bronchoconstriction. It causes bronchoconstriction. So, by causing bronchoconstriction, it stimulates cough. It causes production of cough and shortness of breath. Okay, so it causes cough, shortness of breath, etc. In the lungs, it causes bronchoconstriction. And in the blood vessels, we are talking about the functions of bradykinin. In the blood vessels, it causes vasodilation. It causes vasodilation. And it increases capillary permeability. So by increasing vasodilation, by causing vasodilation and increasing capillary permeability, it leads to, this bradykinin leads to edema formation. So ACE enzyme, angiotensin converting enzyme, it stimulates breakdown of bradykinin. So by breaking down bradykinin, it actually prevents bronchoconstriction, and it also prevents edema formation. Okay, we have to remember this thing. Now let's come to the mechanism of action of angiotensin converting enzyme inhibitors. Of course, angiotensin 2 mediated venoconstriction is lost. There is venodilation, so decreased systolic blood pressure. Angiotensin 2 mediated arteriolo-constriction is lost. There is arteriolo-dilation that leads to decreased diastolic blood pressure. And aldosterone level falls. Okay, there is decreased aldosterone. So there is decreased retention of sodium and water. That means sodium and water will be excreted through the kidneys, and that will lead to decreased blood volume. And ultimately, there will be decreased systolic blood pressure, and there will be no breakdown of bradykinin. Bradykinin will not be broken down, so vasodilation. Bradykinin will cause vasodilation, that will also lead to decreased blood pressure. And there is a fifth mechanism. There is decreased release of antidiuretic hormone, as the angiotensin 2 increases antidiuretic hormone secretion from the posterior pituitary. So by giving angiotensin converting enzyme inhibitors, there will be decreased ADH. So decreased ADH will lead to decreased water retention, that means increased water excretion. Okay, there will be decreased water retention, so increased water excretion, and that will lead to decreased blood volume, and ultimately that will lead to decreased venous return, decreased end diastolic volume, decreased cardiac output, and decreased blood pressure, decreased systolic blood pressure mainly. Now let's look at the drugs. Captopril, enalapril, ramipril, lisinopril, fosinopril, these are some examples of ACE inhibitors. Let's look at the few advantages of these drugs. They easily do not cause postural hypotension. Cardiac output is not affected. Reflex sympathetic stimulation does not occur, and can be safely used in patients with ischemic heart disease. Now let's look at some of the specific drugs. Okay, captopril is not a prodrug, but most of the ACE inhibitors are prodrugs. Okay, its absorption is affected by food, most others are not affected by food. Duration of action is short, half-life about 2 hours. BD dosing is required. Most others are long-acting and single daily dose is enough. And first dose hypotension occurs, with most others are not seen. But with captopril, first dose hypotension is seen. Enalapril is more potent than captopril. Then lisinopril is not a prodrug, reduces cardiac output and cardiac contractility. For sinopril, ramipril, you can look at those drugs. Now let's come to the indications of ACE inhibitors. So ACE inhibitors are used in hypertension. These drugs are one of the most popular drugs nowadays used for hypertension, because they cause no postural hypotension, no rebound hypertension after withdrawal. After withdrawal, you can safely withdraw these drugs. Okay, so no rebound hypertension can be used in asthmatics. You can use these drugs in asthmatic patients as well as diabetic patients, and cardiovascular morbidity is reduced. So hypertension, in case of hypertension, it is very much used. You can use these drugs in congestive cardiac failure because they reduce preload, they reduce afterload, they relieve the sympathetic stress on the heart, and they prevent the cardiac remodeling. Prevent the cardiac remodeling in congestive cardiac failure. Now what happens in congestive cardiac failure? The heart is unable to maintain the oxygen demand. Okay, so in a failing heart, there is more demand and less supply of oxygen due to the heart is unable to pump enough oxygenated blood throughout the body, right? So in congestive cardiac failure, if there is increased preload, okay, suppose this is your heart. Preload means the diastolic volume here. If this is more, then the heart will not be able to pump out all of the blood, because this is a weak heart. In heart failure patient, the heart is very weak. So the heart is weak. So if there is increased end diastolic volume, increased preload, then the heart will not be able to pump out these bloods effectively. Okay, so this is increased preload. So we have to decrease the preload. So if we give this angiotensin converting enzyme inhibitors, that will lead to decreased blood volume and decreased venous return. Thereby, there will be decreased end diastolic volume, and decreased end diastolic volume means decreased preload. So the heart will be very much able to pump out this blood. Okay, and decreased afterload. So when there is increased afterload, suppose this is your heart and the peripheral arterioles, right? So suppose these arterioles are very, very stiff, okay? There is more, these are constricted, these are stiff. So the blood coming through these, so the heart has to give more pressure. It has to exert more pressure, more contraction, more stronger contraction to pass the blood through this narrow and stiff blood vessel. So if you dilate these blood vessels, then the heart will have to work less. So the oxygen demand will decrease and the heart will be able to pump out blood effectively to the peripheral tissues, right? So if you reduce the afterload, then the heart failure patient will be benefited, okay? So by decreasing preload and decreasing afterload, you are actually giving the heart muscle rest, and you are actually benefiting the patient. And this also improves, prevents cardiac remodeling. What happens in heart failure patient, the heart muscle, there is production of bands, okay, fibrous bands, etc. So these are called cardiac remodeling, and that is very, very harmful for the patients. Okay, so that prevents the cardiac remodeling as well in congestive heart failure patients. You can use these drugs in myocardial infarction, started within 24 hours of an attack and continued up to 6 weeks, reduces the long-term mortality. You can use the drug in diabetic nephropathy. Why you can use this drug in diabetic nephropathy? Because afferent and efferent arteriolar constriction in diabetic nephropathy, there is development of glomerular hypertension, damage to the glomerular basement membrane. And if you give ACE inhibitors, there is more efferent arteriolar dilatation, there is relief of glomerular hypertension and condition improves. That means, suppose this is your so this is your glomerulus, and let me draw it more clearly so that you can understand. So the afferent arteriole now this is your glomerulus, this is the Bowman's capsule, this is your glomerulus, and in case of diabetic nephropathy, there is glomerular hypertension, more blood is coming and less blood is passing through here, so here is progressive hypertension, and that leads to damage to the glomerular basement membrane. But if you give ACE inhibitors, that will dilate these things, that will dilate the afferent arterioles. So what will happen, the more blood will come and that will pass through this easily, so this thing, the glomerular basement membrane, will be protected, right? Now in another conditions, in scleroderma crisis, you can use this drug. What happens in scleroderma crisis, which is a connective tissue disease, and there is dermatologic manifestations, right? So sudden excessive rise in blood pressure, it is also called scleroderma renal crisis, where there is sudden increase of blood pressure, and you can use ACE inhibitors or ARBs, these drugs here. Now let's come to the adverse effects. Of course, hypotension can be an adverse effect, because if you give antihypertensive drugs inadvertently, then that can lead to hypotension. First dose hypotension may occur with captopril, and more with congestive heart failure patients with diuretics, and this can lead to hyperkalemia. So why hyperkalemia occurs in these patients, in ACE inhibitor patients? The reason behind this, that you are giving ACE inhibitors, so what happens in angiotensin 2 stimulates aldosterone, right? So aldosterone is an potassium antagonist. So if there is increased aldosterone, there will be less potassium, and if you are blocking this angiotensin 2, you are blocking this aldosterone, right? So what happens, then this decreased potassium will not be decreased, so there will be increased potassium and there will be hyperkalemia. Then come to that can cause dry cough due to bradykinin. So these things, these three things, mainly occur with the ACE inhibitors. These things do not occur with the ARBs. So ACE inhibitors cause dry cough, rashes, angioedema because of bradykinin, because they inhibit the ACE enzyme, and ACE enzyme leads to breakdown of bradykinin. But when you are inhibiting the ACE enzyme, that will not break down the bradykinin, so bradykinin levels will increase, and that will lead to Rykoff, angioedema, rashes, etc. And that can cause teratogenicity if used in pregnancy. Okay. Now come to some drug interactions. ACE inhibitors and diuretics. If you give diuretics along with the ACE inhibitors, then that can cause more reduction in blood pressure. ACE inhibitors and potassium sparing agents, that can cause severe hyperkalemia, because ACE inhibitors cause hyperkalemia, potassium sparing agents cause hyperkalemia, and that combined effect will lead to severe hyperkalemia. ACE inhibitors and antacids, that leads to decreased absorption. Okay, antacids will disturb the absorption of ACE inhibitors, so there will be decreased absorption. ACE inhibitors and indomethacin or NSAIDs as a whole, non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs. If you give ACE inhibitors and non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs, so non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs, they lead to salt retention, water and sodium retention. But ACE inhibitors, they decrease or they prevent the salt retention, water and salt retention. So there will be decreased efficacy of ACE inhibitors. They will counteract with each other, right? And if you give ACE inhibitors and lithium, there will be lithium toxicity. There is a chance of lithium toxicity because ACE inhibitors interfere with the lithium excretion for that reason. Now come to the angiotensin receptor blockers. Angiotensin receptor blockers are drugs like losartan, valsartan, olmesartan, telmisartan, etc. Let's look at the pharmacokinetics of losartan. Losartan is the prototype drug. It is orally available, not affected by food, high phosphorus metabolism, extensive plasma protein binding, has an active metabolite. Most other drugs in this group have active metabolites like losartan. Most are relatively long acting and once daily dosing. Okay, valsartan, olmesartan, telmisartan. Now the indications are the same as the ACE inhibitors, and adverse effects like hypotension, headache, dizziness, mild GI distress, etc. Now let's look at the superiority of ARBs. Why the angiotensin receptor blockers are superior than the ACE inhibitors? Because they directly block the angiotensin receptors. They do not block the angiotensin converting enzyme. They do not block this enzyme. This enzyme is free, okay, and this causes angiotensin 1 to angiotensin 2. Angiotensin 2 is present. Angiotensin 2 is present in the blood, but it cannot act on its receptors. Okay, but this angiotensin is free to break down bradykinin. So bradykinin production is less. So there is no Rykoff, no angioedema. Okay, no Rykoff and no angioedema. Contraindications: you cannot use this drug in pregnancy. It is absolutely contraindicated because of teratogenic effect. You cannot give ACE inhibitors or ARBs, ACE inhibitors or ARBs in pregnancy. Absolutely contraindicated. You have to give some other drugs like alpha methyl dopa or labetalol, etc. Then in case of bilateral renal artery stenosis, you cannot give this drug. Okay. In severe CKD, cannot give this drug. And in case of C1 esterase inhibitor deficiency, you cannot use these drugs. Okay, so these are the contraindications of ACE inhibitors or ARBs. Okay. Now, okay, you may ask me that why in case of bilateral renal artery stenosis, we should not give this drug. Why? Now, suppose these are your kidneys. So these arteries are stenosed. These arteries are stenosed and less blood is coming to this. Okay. So the kidneys are less perfused, hypoperfused. Now, if you give angiotensin converting enzyme inhibitors or ARBs, what will they do? They will decrease sodium and water retention. They will prevent the sodium and water retention. More sodium and water will be lost through the urine. So what will cause, what will be the result? There will be decreased blood volume, and here the kidneys are already hypoperfused because of renal artery stenosis. On top of that, you are reducing the blood volume, so much less blood will come now through this, isn't it? So the kidneys will be more and more hypoperfused. For that reason, these drugs are absolutely contraindicated in these cases. And there is a new drug which is called direct renin inhibitor, like aliskiren. The mechanism of action, it directly inhibits renin and thereby ultimately the production of angiotensin 2. But the benefit of this drug over ACE inhibitor or ARB are not yet established. Usually given as a second line drug, where the first line drugs are not well tolerated. It has some adverse effects like headache, dizziness, diarrhea, etc.